Alex and Allyson.
Oh. Wow.
Oh,
thank you. Thank you, Tiffany. You know, I just wanted to say thank you and thank you to everyone for coming here tonight.
Yes, thank you so much. We're really honored by having this show, which features our work together. It's all, we've been sharing a studio for 46 or so years, always within eyeshot of each other's work, but having our own separate work. And then over the years, doing some work collaboratively too. So, but we have never been offered a show with this many pieces that combines both of our works. And so this is a great honor, I think, to the whole visionary art community, because to feature and highlight the contemporary visionary artists, we were talking about how they had the Summer of Love show at the Whitney in New York, and then they had one out in San Francisco too. Summer of Love, you know, this is like the old visionary art, in a sense, the psychedelic art of the 60s. But anyway, to have a show that brings together so many of the young contemporary artists that we admire, and some that we're even showing at Entheon. So anyway, what we're going to do, though, to start the program is we're going to play you, actually, some of you may have seen this in part already or the whole thing, but we are going to play you the video that is playing in the gallery, because it's a great setup for us. It just really gives you a lot of the information before we begin, and then we're going to talk about the art that's in the show just a little bit, not, you know, like every single piece, but we're going to kind of speak about our work that's in the show, and then we'll have time left over for people to say and talk about what they want to talk about. Okay?
Super.
Are we ready?
Yeah,
John says I should just
so.
Press this bar right here. How about the lights? Should we do the lights first? Turn down the lights, Tiff. There we go. Boom.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
I read the book Be Here Now by Ram Dass, and it inspired me to trip and look for the white light. And I saw the white light. I had never even thought of looking for the white light, and I wasn't leading a spiritual life, but everything seemed unified. And interconnected. All beings and things were unified by this light that ran through everything, inanimate and animate. All things were connected. None of my friends were having a spiritual experience. I felt very isolated by that experience until I met Alex, who was the first person, and that was years later, who actually had a psychedelic experience and talked to me about the sacredness of it and the spiritual experience that was an opening for him. So that was a profound connection with Alex, and that was the beginning of our relationship.
Thank you.
June 3rd, 1976, where he'd taken a massive dose of LSD and entered into an infinite vista of toroidal fountains and drains of light. And it seemed like every being in the universe was one of these balls of light, kind of like a cell in the body of God. It seemed like this was what was really real behind the veil of the material world. It was all made of love. The light was love, and it connected us all.
In every facet, you can see the reflection of every other facet. So it's basically an infinite net of reflection that comes out of the psychedelic experience.
It all starts with drawing, you know, and, well, really starts with altering your consciousness so that you have a vision in some sense. Because consciousness is the ultimate medium. What you're trying to do as an artist is to have an experience that is worth sharing and then download it into another person's consciousness. I think we are a continuum of consciousness. Everything, everyone, everywhere, every when. It's kind of moot, you know? We're a continuum of God selves. And whether we recognize it or not is our own, like, stage on the path. So, I am you. You are me, really. We are sacred mirrors.
Well, chaos theory talks a lot about patterns in nature. So you see, like, if you're watching a stream and it goes around rocks, there's chaos to that, but there's an incredible order to it. And when you're doing psychedelics, you experience the blending of these polarities. You know, the chaos and order becomes one. You see the pattern in nature. And even though it's called chaos, it's all made of the same thing. That's what I express in my work. The chaos in my work is made of the same material that the order is made of. It's all made up of particles and waves, or particles and systems, cells and systems. You know, it makes up chaos and it makes up order. So chaos really is order. It's like a different kind of order. And when you do psychedelics, you resolve these polarities. You resolve all polarities.
Chapel of Sacred Mirrors was based on a vision that Allyson and I had back in 1985. And it finally came to fruition in 2004. We opened our doors in New York City, in Chelsea, and for 5 years it was a nexus for visionary culture in Manhattan. In 2009, we moved up to the Hudson Valley to build a temple. And this is an experiment in art and spirit and community.
It's a great honor to be able to provide a container for creative uplifting. People here find love. They have a place where they can go with their hungry soul, just to feel connected with other people who are good-spirited and have good intentions. It raises your entire being to a higher level of expectation of yourself.
We traveled to arenas and festivals across the world to share with friends the value of creating an enduring sacred site and to declare our commitment to building a sanctuary of visionary art.
We studied sacred sites and spoke with spiritual community builders across five continents.
In 2014, the town planners approved the building of Entheon, transforming a three-story carriage house into a stunning 12,000 square foot exhibition of the finest original works of visionary art.
Entheon, Sanctuary of Visionary Art, exhibits works pointing to the sacredness of all life and a future planetary civilization. Entheon offers a gathering place, honoring all traditions that bring people closer to the divine. The Cosm Permanent Collection and the annually rotating exhibition of original works by accomplished masters of visionary art will celebrate the mystical experience, humanity's touchstone to spirit. Entheon is a legacy gift from the Love Tribe to the global family for contemplation, ceremonies, and spiritual creative programs.
Art is an echo of the creative force that birthed the galaxies. Creativity is the way that the cosmos evolves and communicates with itself. The great uplifting of humanity beyond its self-destruction is the redemptive mission of art. Thank you. Thank you.
We're going to have a little bit of a changeover to show the images on the screen of our that are part of the. We're going to show you the images that are part of the gallery. So grateful. I'm so grateful to these people who worked on this video and, you know, brought some of our, you know, like our message and our life to life for you. And I think they did a great job. I'd get very emotional seeing my life like that. But anyway.
TJ Squires, our wonderful editor who's part of the staff there at COSM. We're so lucky. Anyway, he put that magical thing together, and we feel super grateful. And he did it really for the Mesa show here, but it made us feel, we saw all kinds of stuff we didn't even know existed that they found, you know, in the depths of the memory banks.
Well, we're very grateful for the people who help us, and that's just beyond the beyond, but here we are with the beyond within, and our greatest show here, and there's Rainbow Eye Ripple. You want to say something about Rainbow Eye Ripple?
Well, it contains a strategy that is part of Allyson's body of work, you know, the square nested inside of a square, inside of a square, and so on, and then I just throw some eyes on it, you know.
I like to call it the intervagination of space. That's
yes.
You know, it's roiling. But anyway, so we're gonna go forward here. Let's see. This piece is also outside of the main gallery, and it's a composite piece. I did a lot of broken pieces, and chaos to me is a field. It represents the field of the material world, where all things are broken, and in entropy. But beautiful, and so everything is just a swatch of that world. We're just all like made of the same fabric, and so this swatch is called Madonna and Child. It's, you know, it's just the shapes that it. Yeah, I think I went for the Christian theme. I had one called Pietà, which where's the, you know, the one figure was falling onto the other figure, but. Anyway, it's a large wall piece. I love it.
Christchild's got a hat.
Yeah. Anyway, then I can tell you that for 2 years I did ink washes, and I practiced the gray scale, which is 10 steps from black to white and back to black in 9 more steps. Basically, it goes across the diagonal. Anyway, I created this the drawing is the same in all squares of the checkerboard, but some of them, wherever the black starts, is dependent on the way the square looks. So I was realizing this, that I could create these different patterns by starting the black in different corners. And I was practicing art as meditation. I was practicing art as a spiritual path, because I was basically doing this sort of Zen meditation. It was just ink, water, and a very 000 Series 7 brush, and, you know, very few hairs, and just, you know, these very small and fine paintings. And you had to go gradating through the grays, you know, all 10 grays, do them as orderly as possible.
You spent years doing those.
I did. You know what the years were? I'll just tell you, because you're all friends of ours. Look at the intimacy of this group. I had a child. After 13 years of being married, and we tried once to be parents, once in 13 years. The rest of the time, we tried not to be parents.
It worked.
And we had our one and only daughter when I was 36. So even though I knew I couldn't, I wanted to do the parent training. I wanted us to do the parent training. It was the life training. Within the life training, there's the parent training. And I thought, even if we only have one, it would be really wonderful to go through that experience. So
it includes
And
it includes postpartum depression.
Well, that's the thing. That's where I was
the
going.
Life
yeah.
Training.
It's amazing how your identity shift really kind of takes it out of you. And if you have any kind of penchant for depression that was hidden, and I didn't even realize that I was so moody all my life, I did have a penchant for depression. Anyway, it all came out in those 2 years, but I kept making art, and that's the important thing. You know, the making art was just, it just helped me so much pull myself out of depression. And the other thing that helped me, if anybody wants to know, exercise. I went back to, teaching aerobics, and it was like, whoa, serotonin, okay. But that's what happened. I did these ink washes, and then I went into oils and brought red back into the painting.
That's right.
So I brought a couple of those here. I
did. The blood returned.
All of these. Exactly. I never stopped making art, and that, I think, brought me right around. And I really did do, for every two you're seeing here, there was like probably 10. And I've saved a couple of them, really nice ones. So, but anyway, perfect. Perfect in my work means that there's nothing overlapping. You know, everything is, just lined up, but you have this roiling, fountains and drains, like the suck holes and blow holes that you could create from a simple pattern, a grid. And it goes through the spectrum in 19 steps. So anyway, I have 19 colors. And chaos, order, and secret writing, vertical, chaos, order, secret writing, checkerboard. This is my attempt to combine chaos, order, and secret writing in one painting. So it's like chaos, this was the voice, it said, chaos and order can exist simultaneously without conflict. So that kind of became, how do you paint that, you know? So I played with that. I just have to say, my work changed drastically when I met Alex, okay, on a dime. I just started doing the secret writing stuff because Alex recognized it in my work, and I was kind of hiding it. I wasn't making art in art school about my secret writing, and Alex said, this is the stuff. Because we got together on psychedelics, and Alex, made me realize how important this vision that I had that was in the video, was to my work, and I just started sinking myself into it. And my master's thesis was around secret writing. So anyway, but I put these two pieces together because the one is chaos. It's just a small chaos field. It was done in 87. It's old, beautiful. I love that little piece. It's just an adorable little one. But since chaos goes in all directions infinitely, you can cut a swatch anywhere, in any shape, and they're all unique. Everyone is completely unique. So that's a unique swatch, the chaos small. But on the left side, it's complementary planned randomness, and that's a principle in chaos. It's basically, if you're painting chaos, like on the right-hand side of the screen, you are painting a frozen moment of chaos. Do you know what I'm saying? It's like everything's falling apart in this beautiful, colorful way. All the spectrums, that are neatly placed together are all falling apart. And so on the left-hand side, complementary is the complementary colors. So even though it's planned randomness, you can put any color anywhere, the color that's inside of each square is the complement, say, on the color wheel, the opposite on the color wheel, of that color. So that's the way my mind works, in that kind of structural manner. And it's how your art can look like you. But anyway, you see planned randomness in chaos. So Orb has four circles, and Lizard King has 16 circles or dots or diamonds. So that's the difference between those two, and they're oil paintings, they're related. This is basically deconstructed Harlequin diptych. That means that on the left-hand side is the drawing for the right-hand side. So I did the drawing twice, and I painted one. And the drawing in the upper half is a chaos letters on, it's chaos letters on an order background. And the lower one is order letters on a chaos background. So you can see that that's the way it turns out to be in the in opposites. I like polarities and blending them. Same thing goes here, order background with chaos letters, chaos background with order letters. And these are the first and last letters of the alphabet. The alphabet is not translatable, it's unpronounceable, and it has 20 letters. This is a complementary mandala. That means that, yeah, it's a mandala. But the letters are not complimentary. I don't think that that's really the right title, but the letters are white. And on the other side, on the right-hand side, the letters are the complement of the squares that they're sitting in, and it's a mandala. So anyway, there's the secret writing. And Order with Chaos Island, just playing, you know what I mean? How do you put chaos on top of order and make it like a chaos island? This I call smush, because all the letters got smushed together. We both did quite a few paintings on the road. We did them, and you saw us doing paintings, starting them anyway, and then finishing them in the studio. And this is one of those that I did. And I think we're coming on to your section. Oh, no, I have a couple more. Chaos Field. Just like I was saying, every swatch is different. This is a watercolor. You notice the quality difference of the watercolor from the oils. It's just, I love watercolor. In fact, this is what I'm going to show you. This is my gem series. This is the first place I've ever exhibited it or even had them scanned. This is the work that I'm doing right now, and I've completely changed over during COVID to triangles. I don't know why. I had to do triangles, but I just really love filling in stuff. There's just no getting around it. I love filling in stuff, and I love... Well, like I practice piano every day too, and I practice my scales first. So I always feel that it's a meditation, and that, you know, the filling in and the figuring out is all very calming and peaceful, and I do it every day. So these are the gem series, and you'll see them in the gallery. And I have one on the table right now. I've got one, and I'm just adoring doing watercolors, and they're so completely fun. And I recommend it to everybody because they're just such a simple kit. You know, if you want to try art, it's just such a simple kit of colors. And write to me to find out what the kit is comprised of. I have a blog for 20 years called Ask Allyson About Art and Life. And I talk to people about art and life all the time. But one thing I do talk about is what materials do you want to work with? You know, what sort of space do you want to have? That sort of thing. So I'll tell you about my materials. But here's Alex's first piece you're going to talk about. Yay, thank you.
Wow, thank you, Allyson. Woo! Amazing. I love how the new works add a whole new kind of language. You know, that's in the development, but they're some of the most beautiful and charming, and they add the facets add an element of chaos to a very orderly system, which is fascinating. A dissipative structure in some sense.
It's the way they dry. It's water drying, and you can see it in each cell. You know, I love that.
Yeah, amazing. Well, this is a painting called Promise, and it kind of features a couple fashioned after Allyson and I, but we had a daughter who did have red hair, and still does, yes. And this kind of shows the heart connection and promise that they're making to kind of stay together or make the family work and everything like that. And there's also, I thought there's the promise of spirit coming into form, you know, so from up high, there's a soul being fashioned by some weird hallucinogene, you know, in the center there. Meanwhile, there's their firstborn is fondling a skull below, gee whiz. And so I guess that everything is born as, you know, passes and things, so this is something we all got to remember. In the background, at the edges, can you see the older forms, of the elders that are behind them, kind of pushing them forward? This is kind of a portrait of our daughter, Zena, you know, and I thought she got in a car and drove out to California right after she graduated from like high school, basically. And so she showed a lot of creative initiative, a lot of creative will. And I think that's something that, you know, that's like any creative endeavor we have, it just like takes like a kind of a sense that, I don't know, I'm gonna try it anyway, you know, and you gotta turn your mind toward it first, you know, before you can accomplish anything. So, and of course, it's the old kind of symbol that I developed for tool as well. So, baptism in the ocean of awareness. Well, gee, it's raining eyeballs. I'm drowning in eyeballs. No, I don't know. That's how do you portray, you know, a meltdown into the ocean of awareness? You know, here's a way. Yeah, really. Gee, well, you know, Allyson and I have been doing this class for probably 20 years where we're drawing the body and soul. So we spend a day, sometimes we spend, you know, like longer, an hour per chakra or something like that. But mostly it's 20 minutes or 30 minutes, and we say that the model will take a pose suggestive of that kind of the energy of that energy center. So then you got sort of the connecting with the ground. That's more or less the first chakra. And so she's well grounded, you know. And then the second chakra is more about the emotions and the flow. So she's more in a kind of contrapposto and mood. Here, it's more about thinking and about rationality, you know. That's the kind of the solar plexus chakra. And so she's got a hold of something there and contemplating it. And so then it moves up to the heart center. And I tried to, you know, just bring a series of these wavicles and a sense of dynamism into it. And then the upper chakras, you know, after the heart, you know, things kind of turn toward a more spiritual dimension, you know, because the thoughts and emotions and, you know, groundedness and your instincts for survival, that's pretty much any ego would have those things, you know. If you open up your heart chakra and have some kind of sense of love, either for a pet or for a friend or a, you know, a mate or something like that, you know, that helps turn things around a little bit, you know, and you can open up, you can sense a trust to the universe that there's some plan, there's something unfolding for you, you know. And that your soul has a means of expression, you know? And so the voice and finding one's voice, you know, that's this, or when one can speak to spirit, you know, and pray, or when one speaks for spirit, you know? And so finding your voice, then seeing into the upper worlds, into the visionary worlds, you know, that's what the third eye is about there in a contemplative state. And then put it all together and you're a rainbow.
Our favorite color.
Yeah. Fractalize. Oh, I was trying to imagine what is the micro kind of views of an angel. You know, if you could look at an angel's skin, would it have kind of hair on it? And but what would that hair look like? So this is like an angel's hair. So when Buddha became kind of enlightened, you know, he was in a kind of a frightening situation under the Bo tree, you know, and Mara, the great disruptor and distractor, you know, was saying, ah, you enlightened, who's your witness? And And Buddha basically said, the earth is my witness. And so the earth witness posture is when the Buddha touches the earth. And I thought, at that moment, you know, when an enlightened being touches the ground, it's like it sends off a signal directly to Galactic Central. Somebody woke up! Somebody, look, over here, the earth, can you believe it? Yeah. Whoa, he must have had one of these. I don't know. Perhaps. Well, around the world, the psilocybin mushroom, you know, has been consumed for millennia. Actually, still illegal in the United States. But it was basically the kind of a foundation of a religious experience for people, you know, that they, it wasn't like you had to believe in God. You could meet God, you know, hang out with God for a few hours even, you know, and if you were lucky. And it wasn't all fables. It was your direct experience. Now you knew. Now you didn't have to take somebody's word for it. You could own that, you know, contact with something divine and sacred in the very world you live in. What a miracle. Anyway, I think psilocybin is that flesh of the gods. And all around it, you can see these various kinds of images, some of which, let's see, is this a laser here? Oh, yes. All right, well, there's petroglyphs of all kinds, but in Africa especially, and the Tassili kind of mushroom character, this is one of the runners, but there's a number of mushroom art in Algeria now, you know, and along the Silk Road, they found this burial shroud recently, and it was supposed to be a reenactment of the Soma ceremony. So, you know, in the Rig Veda, the world's oldest religious text, talks about Soma, and Soma is a psychedelic. But, you know, they weren't sure exactly which one it was or what it was. I don't know. This looks like something to me. Yeah, and so if you take it, you look like these guys. And, of course, at Eleusis, they might have used it now and then. Adam and Eve were known to play with trees and fruit. Let's see, Hindu mushroom head, and all the way up to, look, Osiris, what are you growing? I think I see something. It's not a bowling pin. Over here, we've got, in Utah, you know, you've got the three kinds of visionary art. There's the realistic kind, you know, and then there's the abstract, and then there's the symbolic. So in a petroglyph, you've got the three kinds of visionary art, and you've got a depiction of the visionary experience. If you take some of this, beep, 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 you go there, you know? Look at this guy, it's got mushroom eyes, you know? This is from Hawaii. See, they were growing it there, too. They've got an indigenous mushroom culture there. And, of course, we know the Mayan culture. And look at all these things from South America. The mushrooms are very big in the Americas. So it's kind of perhaps next year or the year after that, we're going to be having some legalized psilocybin for the, relief of certain things like depression and PTSD and a lot of the things that, thank God for ketamine, that's, Thank you, James, for making it happen here in Phoenix. Good grief. Awesome. So if you're feeling depressed and or want to just explore your consciousness, there is a ketamine clinic in town. So that's an interesting thing, and that's a legal psychedelic, kind of. And so here is the Blue Moon Mushroom. It only comes out at the Blue Moon. They're very rare. And they're beaming with Allyson's language. So I'd been thinking of a very weird painting for quite a number of years. It had been showing up in my sketchbooks, and I had no idea how I was ever going to realize it. I thought, maybe Patreon. If I got enough people secretly, you know, like that, you have to keep the secret. I got to do this big painting. You know, you got to help me. And so, but no, it turned out Tool called me up right when I was thinking like that. And they said, hey, you got any ideas for a thing that you got to do, but you haven't done yet? And it, nobody's seen it or anything like that. But, you know, but it might be cool for us. And I had the idea, you know, of the great turn. So I worked on this. This is the study that's here in the show. Now, this is the finished piece. I guess it's saying it's a print there. But and there was a print series. But so the piece, gosh, can we shut off the lights that are beaming onto the darn, is that possible, Johnny? So is it possible to shut down these lights that are going onto the screen? Just asking. I just thought you could see the darn art for a little while. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, this is the great turn. And so after painting this for over a year, I felt like, I think I know what this is. This is it's very simple. So you got these three main elements. First, you've got the body. And then I think this net is the mind. See this net? And then behind it, there's this tunnel of eyes. It just seems to go on infinitely and all the way down to the, you know, darker realm. So you've got basically a body, mind, and spirit kind of portrait. And, you know, certainly the body is all ensnared in the mind and trying to figure things out and flip-flopping all around, you know, and is in a terrible situation there, you know, it looks like. Meanwhile, it's being observed by the spirit, completely witnessed, you know, and that tunnel of eyes is also who we are, the witness of our own drama. So it's just a choice. Where are you gonna stick, you know? You want to stay in the muck of the mind and the body, or have a little minute of peace and pop out for a moment, get some perspective, just, you know, pat yourself on the head and get back.
Wait a minute. Is my mic still on? Okay, good.
Yeah.
I just wanted to say that this painting, actual painting, the finished piece, it looks just like this, and it looks just like the print that's out there. It was a limited edition print. Is 8 feet by 10 feet tall, which means that the man was on and off of a scaffold all day, all night, for over a year.
That's my COVID painting.
It's this
painting.
COVID painting.
Does
up and
it
down
feel
on the
familiar
scaffold
to anyone? Yeah.
But he likes to do it life size or larger, which means that you've got like double the torso, which is elongated too.
Yeah.
It's a phenomenal painting, and it is on view, or will be when Entheon opens.
Yeah.
the original painting, but you have some of the sketches and the you know, the attendant material,
right,
the preliminary material that you did. It's beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful. It's one of, and this is it in the show.
Yeah, well,
Genevieve Wood took this picture.
Tonight.
She's here tonight. She was at the show,
and one of her shots is there in the show. I grabbed a different shot from the same show, but just to show you the scale. And of course, they had stadiums. You know, this was from the Portland show. Now, see, the painting got involved in their last album, which won a Grammy. But this was a strange album. It has a little video inside of it. I don't know if anyone's seen it. But and it also used this character. We affectionately call him Turner, or
D.M. Turner.
D.M. Turner, yeah. And so... but then the larger edition came out in a book form, which is in part of the ephemera there.
Now,
yeah. Now, one of the things that was sweet was that that Danny agreed to allow this drum set, which he played there in Portland, to be exhibited here. It's never been exhibited in a museum. Probably,
I don't know whether it ever will again.
But
the Danny Carey for Tool is considered by many to be the greatest drummer alive. I just wanted to. Some people may not know him, but as a drummer, he's like one of these people with the multi arms. He's like that guy.
Yeah, it's right. He's like the Avalokiteshvara of drums or something. Yeah, so.
Tool.
Yeah. So, and anyway, it's hard to see this piece there, but this is there. But this is unwrapped. See, our friend John Harris, who's sitting over here with Genevieve, he took a photograph of a barrel. You know, like I painted it as a drum, see? So it was around, it wasn't a flat thing. And so he had to figure out, how do you photograph a drum and make it flat? So thank you, John. This is a shot he took that shows Danny's eardrum, which I wanted to make one of the drums really special. And so I thought, like, wouldn't it be funny, you know? It's like, there's Danny, you know, he's visioning, like thinking of a new thing, or he's hearing this, he's hearing the rhythms of the universe, you know, through some kind of shamanic vision there, you know. And so he's drumming. And the drum, see the little blue line, the little blue spark in the center? That kind of beat is what goes through then the ear and through the eardrum itself and through his brain and stuff like that. Anyway. This was just kind of a funny idea that I feel really grateful to have had the experience.
It's going on tour, so yeah. It's only going to be here for another like couple of weeks, which is why we had to make it out here now before they took it back, because the boys are going to be back on tour again. The thing is, this came out like really February. We saw them in Brooklyn, and we saw them
in October.
Was it really October?
October
2019.
Okay,
but by mid-March, their tour just ended.
Yeah.
Or was...
The last show, when was that, Genevieve?
Beginning of COVID.
Now they're
they had
be back
to shut everything down. So the Fear Inoculum tour got called off because of a pandemic.
But Fear Inoculum... Can you imagine the foresight that Maynard had? It's
good
incredible.
God. Yeah, no,
you
it's
know.
Totally freaky, really, actually.
Maynard is right here in Arizona.
Yeah.
You guys,
Merkin
seriously.
Vineyards,
Merkin
super.
Vineyards, so awesome.
Now you got
to
check it
restaurant.
Out if
it's
you
really
haven't been there.
The wine that guy's making, seriously.
Seriously.
Truly the best wines, yeah.
Anyway, but here we are.
More Tool... Abelia, I guess, but the piece was made in, actually it was made in 93, not 95. It was our first, kind of my first flash of a DMT trip. And so you know, you can never reproduce something that's infinite, you know, but you can point to it, and people who've been there kind of recognize that. And our friend Brian Chambers loaned this and a number, and this painting as well, which he commissioned, the Vision Crystal Tondo, and we made a special frame for it. It's kind of, it. You could think of it as an angel. I think of it as an angel. You know, like in a psychedelic space, infinite consciousness can come in a lot of different flavors. And here's a kind of a compositional structure that I've used to juxtapose the idea of a timeless being that is embedded in time. And so that we can identify, you know, with that being in time and that succession, or that something, that ageless something that is the I am presence in the center of our being, that's always awake and that's always, you know, always you, you know? And so I like to see them both. The Cosmic Mother, these are some shots I shot in the studio, but this bronze statue is there, and it's really this series of the Cosmic Mother. There's only 13 of them, several of them are gone, and this series helps to finance the Cosmic Mother that's in the stairwell of Entheon. And so it's coming along, and she's been, she's here. I mean, she's at Entheon. And this is another kind of collaboration.
She's what, 7 or 8 feet tall?
Seven.
So the sculpture that's out there is a sample of the edition of 13, whereas it's helping us to have the sculpture for the temple, which is 7 feet tall, I believe.
Yeah, I should have put that in here. Anyway,
it's, okay.
It's one of the delights that you'll
have. Yeah, because it's painted.
You come to see Entheon.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, wow.
Well, these are the collaborative paintings, really, mm-hmm. that, you know, we are have had the privilege. It's been tough for us to paint together. We're so used to painting on opposite sides of the studio. But I love this. This was a proposal of Alex's, and we can move on. We've seen this. Take
right.
a look at it. We painted it over several live painting episodes and then brought it back to the studio to finish it nicely, and I think it turned out wonderfully. I love seeing it with its gold frame.
Yeah.
It looks so gorgeous.
Now, Mesa, the museum here just did an outstanding job. And
Star Dancers, can I tell something about Star Dancers?
Oh, go right
why
ahead.
Why don't I start off? Anyway.
2007,
there it says it. Well, in 2007, we were invited to come down to Sao Paulo, Brazil, to the Tribe Festival, where it's a 24-hour festival. It basically starts, you know, like maybe 6 o'clock in the afternoon and ends at 6 o'clock the next afternoon. Nobody sleeps, and everybody stays up and dances all night. So we had this, you saw us painting it in that video. We had this stage of our own under a structure, and it was an 8 by 8 foot box. And so this painting started as an 8 by 8 wrapping around, because it's 8 feet tall and it's 34 feet around. So the first couple of times we painted it was at this festival, and we had about 20 hours marathon overnight to paint it, and then we went back maybe 5 years later. But in the meantime, it was rolled up. It was made on canvas so we could get it down to Sao Paulo in its own little, you know, big plastic tube, you know, that it has. And then after that 20 hours, this is a big piece, and it 20 hours isn't that much. We had it sort of drawn on there, and we painted it as fast as we could, put just rough things in, you know. But then 5 years later, we went back to the Tribe Festival and did it again, and for another marathon. But then we wrapped it up again until Burning Man. Well, no, we did it in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, for Vice magazine, and anywhere that we could get people to build a wall that was that big for us, we would unroll the thing and paint a little bit more. But like, it was only a few hours at a time, or maybe a few days, like Burning Man called. And so for 5 summers, we did it at Burning Man before COVID. And we had it up for 4 days. So from like 4 o'clock to five, from noon to five every day we would be painting. But that's not enough. We needed more. So Mesa called and said, we have like these infinite walls, you know, that are just gigantic, and you got to fill them. We thought, we got to get this thing out and work on it. So we rolled it out at Entheon, which is the main gallery. The big gallery is empty right now. So we had this wall, and we worked on it for 6 weeks straight, every night and every weekend. We worked on it to try to get it up to where you're seeing it now, which is about 65% finished. What do you think? We have a long way to go. We have to keep building walls for it. But
it's been fun, and it shows its wear and tear, you know, but it's been through a lot of festivals, and it kind of carries the stomped in dust, you know, from the playa.
Well, tell them what the environment is that we painted at the playa.
Oh my God! For the last 4 years, we've been at the Foam Dome, and the Foam Dome is something that, you know, when you're at the playa, it's really hot. You know what hot is? You know what it is? And you get like this dust all over you. It's kind of a mess, you know. Really, you're sweaty, and you got the dust And then, my God, a foam dome? You come in and they spray foam all over you. It's David Bronner has this, you know, it's made out of natural materials.
Just let me explain it. People have to get
naked, okay? There's hundreds of naked people that go into like a car wash, but it's like a people wash. And then they put the foam on, and then they, you know, rinse them off, and then they come out and they start dancing. You know, it's just like, because there's a DJ, you know, and you're naked. And so and what's happening? Grandma and Grandpa are painting this.
So one side is the tunnel. It's a plexi tunnel that they spray you, and about 25 or 30 people go in one side. And there's a dance floor in the middle, and then there's the DJ, and then we are on the other side with our wall. So that's been divine. That's really a fun thing that we do. And I don't know whether that'll keep happening, whether Burning Man is going to happen, whether we'll be there with our mural again, but we hope to finish it one day, and God knows where it'll go.
Has anybody here experienced the Foam Dome?
Any foam domers? Foam domers.
There's a few hands.
People stand in line for 45 minutes to get. The thing about Burning Man, though, is that if you hadn't been there, everything's free. Once you get inside the door, you can put your wallet away. Nothing. Everything has to be a gift. Oh, yeah. You can go to the coffee station and get coffee or ice.
Ice.
But that's it. Everything else is gifts. So people are always gifting. It's a gift economy. So you have to stand in a long line, but they try to make the line really, really interesting and everything, and it is. So, but people come in and they want to shower in there. It's one of a gazillion things that go on at Burning Man, but it's very popular. And it's
transformation is what it is.
Transformation.
Yeah.
All right, and here's creating a better world.
Yeah,
this we brought was the drawing.
Yeah, it's a drawing. It's kind of Adam and Eve return to the garden. To try and create a better world. They're basically artists. And so we wanted to portray the Tree of Knowledge being all the different wisdom traditions and, you know, the realm of creatures and a sustainable planetary civilization. We can dream. And so we made a little plaque. And it's really the doors of Entheon.
Wait a minute.
Okay.
Okay. So Alex did this drawing, and he did it like, you know, as big as doors. This was our plan, was to have these bronze doors for the Chapel of Sacred Mirrors, which is our Entheon. But so the drawing was blown up to 8 feet by 8 feet. We made a plaque. It's a beautiful plaque. And there it is. But then you have one here to see. But the doors of Entheon, you saw them in the video. They're there. They actually, it was like visioning it into being, Alex. I mean, you visioned it. You did a little drawing and turned it into this. And this.
Yep.
Bronze doors, each of them
growing.
700 pounds. They have to open with 5 pounds of pressure for ADA compliance. You know,
guess
who helped us do that? Burning Man people.
Cosm Grail, we sometimes do marriage ceremonies.
We do.
And we all take a little sip.
Of holy
Pre-COVID.
Water.
Pre-COVID.
Of holy water from our holy land. Yeah. That's where we have our own wells. And there's the Entheon. You have one here. And our friend here is a collector
James,
of the Entheon.
Thank you for getting
it's,
one.
We're like, we, look, we have a... We became a church. In 1996, we became a nonprofit. But in 2008, we became a church. It just... An interfaith, a radically welcoming interfaith art church. That's what we say is Cosm. So we felt when my parents both died, basically, Alex designed this as an urn. And we had it made in bronze. And so it is an unlimited edition, but they're all numbered. And they're just, you know, a church should have that for people these days. And my father, we have one for my father.
Yeah, I'm really grateful that you inspired that. It's for your ashes or your stashes.
Or your stashes, yeah. Start out with the stashes, and then later you can go to the ashes.
Yeah. So the soul bird is also here, and this was inspired by the trip to Egypt, really. Some archetypes came back with me, you know. This is clearly the Ba, you know, that is the... and the soul bird is really what I think is the divine imagination.
Wait, I have something to say about the soul bird.
Yeah.
Okay, I just wanted to say the ones that you have here are just gorgeous bronze. I have one myself on our humidor. I love the soul bird. But the thing is, we have two giant ones at Entheon. We have 2 9-footers. You know, this was funded by Alex's parents. And
yeah, Walt
so
and Jane.
You can see them right here.
Walt
exactly.
Jane.
We're going to call them Walt and Jane.
Yeah.
That when we get them set up, we're still working on the pedestals. But
yeah, which one's Walt and which one's
this is a,
Jane?
This is a this is a computer. I want everybody to understand that this is a computer model. That the building itself has not had sculpture hung on it yet, except for it has a steeple head. It has the doors. It has the soul birds. And it also has a sculpture inside, one interior sculpture. And so there's a few sculptures that have been funded. People fund various things. You know, my floor, I don't know if you noticed the floor in the video, but... It was funded, so we have different things that people decide to fund.
We got a couple of contributors who together made $100,000. It really helped do this project, and here they are.
They're responsible for these 800-pound doors. They open with like a feather.
You're really nice.
Press of a button. Here is the All One Gallery. The Gallery of the International Visionary Artists. This is where we're going to be having our inaugural exhibition. It'll be a rotating show of contemporary visionary artists. And right now we're doing, you know, like a composite show, like very much like the kind of show that was curated here. You know, the best of, you know, some of the best works that are originals that we can show. So that, because a lot of these artists, they keep these works in their studio, their best work, they keep it. You know, they sell prints and they sell all this, you know, everything. But we want to show the originals like you have here. It's so wonderful to show people's work. And,
you know, also on the first floor, there's the psychedelic reliquary. And so this is just this sort of the, things are getting laid out here. we've got a lot of ephemera and things from libraries and signed stuff from Aldous Huxley and, you know,
Timothy Leary.
And Albert Hoffman signed a bunch of things. And it turns out that we had, for a while, the generous collector has allowed us to hold this painting of Ram Dass. And it's extraordinary because he blessed it.
And she's here,
and
too.
Stephanie, and thank you, Gerhard. We're so grateful. Ram Dass, we took the painting out so that he could see it, you know, and give us
it out to his home.
Give us some pointers. He's out in Hawaii, and he received us, and he had a few comments. He did like the Hanuman, though, I have to say, so that saved me. And I got a lot of pointers that I put into effect in the final painting, so I really was grateful for that. And he was so sweet, and we wanted to get his blessing on the painting, you know, because I think of it as a relic. I think of him as this, you know, American guru. What an extraordinary life. Starts out as a professor at Harvard, you know, at the top of his game, really, you know. And and then he meets up with Tim Leary, good gods. And, you know, things take a shift. He becomes an expert in psychedelics. And then things take a real shift. The spiritual opening that he got from psychedelics made him ready for a transmission from one of the great spiritual masters.
I have to say something about all this. Okay, in 1971, when this book, Be Here Now, came out, I read it and it changed my life. I went from being an agnostic Jew, you know, but basically, you know, politico, to being a spiritual person. I mean, I lost all my friends. I had to like completely find a new community to go meditate with. And this book really like sent me in that direction. I did the work. I did the LSD, but you know, it really sent me in a direction that I hadn't been in. So if you say anything to thank Ram Dass, he would always say, "It isn't me, it's Maharaji." So that's the guy who's above his head, Maharaji. And if Maharaji was ever complimented, he would always say, "It's not me, it's Hanuman. I get it all through Hanuman." Hanuman is the monkey god in the front. So I just say, if it weren't for Ram Dass, I would not have met Alex, because it was really, I knew Alex in my class, but it was really your psychedelic experience that you had in my apartment, his first, where he saw God, that really, like, I had never been able to talk to anybody about this. You know, like, if you talk to the meditating people, they don't want to hear about you're doing drugs. They don't want to hear about that. You know, that was back in the 70s. But if you're talking to, you know, the people that I hung out with, they didn't want to hear about spirituality. So there was just this, like, shut up, you know, don't talk about it, but just like, keep it a secret, like a side art. And then you came along and found it the most important thing, and we made a life together. And I just have to say, I am grateful to Hanuman, Maharaji, Ram Dass, and the whole retinue, you know, for my life, because if it weren't for Hanuman, you know, I mean, seriously, I wouldn't have met you. That's all.
That's right. Thank you, Hanuman.
You have any more?
And thank you, Stephanie, for commissioning this portrait. We're really deeply grateful for
allowing us to loan it to us
for
exhibited in Entheon. You must come and see it while it's there, because we have some loaners. Oh, this is my room. This is Chaos Order Secret Writing Zone. And like I was saying, my floor was funded by wonderful people who loved my idea and took it up, and we found people from through Burning Man to make this inlaid floor of my secret writing with tiles. They made tiles. Anyway, there's wallpaper, there's four different kinds of wallpaper. It's crazy, it's maniacal. It goes through four and a half decades of my evolving work with Chaos Order and secret writing, primarily. I mean, it's like, I've evolved it through many permutations, many lives.
How many letters are on that wall that you hand
painted? Oh, 1,026 letters. I hand painted that freestanding wall, which was the wall for a couple of really important pieces of mine, Realms of the Unpronounceable, and a collaborative piece is on the other side. So something that leads to Alex's room is a collaboration between the two of us. So you'll see when you come to Entheon, you're going to have to come. We're not open quite yet, but we will be, and we will love seeing all of you there. You'll have to tell us that you met us here. You talk about this. Look at this.
Right. Well, this is kind of the, I think of it as the centerpiece of the Sacred Mirror series. And this room we were able to create inside of this building was amazing, because it, on the outside, it looks like a big brick wall, like a what is a brick wall doing here with a doorway that is the shape of this frame? And so when you come in, you've got this zigzagging floor and the zigzagging kind of ceiling. And it's like a womb for the gestation of the awakening human spirit. That's the intention. And the psychic energy system, spiritual energy system, and universal mind lattice kind of recounts the meltdown that we mentioned in the video into the universal mind lattice. And so this is the kind of the central mystical experience that is highlighted in the Sacred Mirror series. And we feel like, I don't know, it's all unfolding so amazingly. We can barely believe it ourselves, really. You know, we've been able to get a lot done during the COVID intermission. And of course, Entheon is still not quite open.
Well, let me just say, though, that this came from a vision that we had in 1985. We'd already been together for many years, but Zena hadn't been born yet. Anyway, we had this vision of creating a temple for them. Alex had painted all these paintings. But what are we going to now do with them? Because if we sold them off individually, it wouldn't have the impact of this installation that we really envisioned. So the installation we envisioned was very large. Somebody was asking us today, what's the secret of success, successfully staying together for 46 years? And I think it's, well, I think it's to immerse yourself in solving a big problem, really. It's basically immersing yourself in a project that is bigger than you. Something that you promise you're going to do, but you don't know how you're going to fulfill that promise, and then you fulfill it. That's it. You just say, okay, if I've made this promise, I'm going to fulfill it, and you just take one step in front of the other toward fulfillment, and you become 70 years old, and you're still doing it. But
still pushing that rock.
Still pushing it, but you know, we've done a lot, you know, having the city place and then having this place without the art on view for 14 years. We had some little galleries in the house, but it was like people kept coming, even though the sacred mirrors were in a closet, you know, somewhere. For 14 years, we worked on the infrastructure of the place and getting permits and raising enough money to build the temple. So now we're getting very close to opening this first temple. We have another temple in mind as well, because we'll never stop. You can just count on us. Let me just say that that COSM stands for Chapel of Sacred Mirrors. And the mission of COSM is to build an enduring sanctuary, enduring sanctuary of visionary art to uplift a global community, which is why we're here. and everywhere that people invite us to talk about Entheon, because it's our mission to build an enduring sanctuary of visionary art to uplift a global, we've been everywhere, community. And we keep telling people about it, and so you can't, you know, our feet are to the fire. People say, how's your temple? You know, everywhere we go in the world, people recognize Alex in all the airports, you know. We just keep telling people about it, and people like the idea. So there are many temples being built all over the world, but this is the Temple of Visionary Art, and we're so grateful for so many people to help helping us make it happen.
We think that sometime next year, already members are getting little monthly tours. And so it's something that's we're already kind of opening and sharing, you know, what's it like to give a tour of this stuff and how long can we do that and not wear people out and or wear ourselves out. And we're still hanging some of the galleries and they're still finishing painting, and the psychedelic reliquary we want to be really cool, and we've got some really wonderful relics, you know, and I'm talking like real stuff. First, you know, like the Ramdas, it doesn't belong to us, but he put his hand on the back of the painting. We had painted his hand blue, and then he signed his name and Ram Ram Ram, you know, and so it's like it's authenticated, and the signing and the touching makes it into a relic of some kind, you know, and it's an art relic, you know. But so the portraits of Dr. Hoffman and Dr. and Ann Shulgin and Stan Groff that are also there, each was signed. And then we have other things like Hoffman's glasses, like that he wore in the painting. His family, after his death, sent us a relic, which was his glasses. And we thought, wow, the lens through which he saw reality change, you know? So we'll have it there in front of the painting. And we also got, see, a painting, a thing that someone signed, that's kind of a third class relic. It's still a relic, you know? That, but then a second class relic is something they wore, you know? So the glasses are a perfect example of a second class. Now, first class relic, that's genetic material. So we have Hair Hoffman, one hair. We'll probably exhibit it in a test tube or something, you know? But we've got things like that. Zach Leary is sending us some ashes of his father, Tim Leary. And so really, things are being assembled and we're trying to treat them in a sacred way, because ultimately we think that this psychedelic experience is a spiritual, opens up a spiritual possibility for people, and that this is its highest function, is to get us back to our spiritual reality, to balance out our lives and help transform the world.
I just wanted to just, I think we're coming close to the end, are we not? And oh yeah, and I just wanted to say, I just wanted to invite you warmly to come to have a tour with us at Entheon once a month. We're doing tours, and if you are inspired, you can just make it a journey and you can come and become a member and do a tour with us. It's our pleasure to meet you there. It's small groups. We're doing very small groups and masked, and you know, we're very careful and everything. But yeah, members can come once a month to have a tour with us, and that's kind of one of our new programs for our slow and gradual opening. We're really not allowed to be open until we get a CFO, but we are allowed to bring in investors. So that's why you have to be a member. So come be a member and enjoy, because we're doing broadcasting. This is what's been going on during COVID, is that we have Our full moon ceremonies, we're about to do our 236th, I believe, full moon ceremony, coming up in a consecutive and unbroken chain since January of 2003, when we started them in our home, to talk to people about, you know, building a temple. And so, so anyway, we continue to do the full moon ceremonies online. We started immediately, as soon as we had to shut down, our next vernal equinox was online, and then since then we've been doing programs and interviews and getting more and more professional with our incredible media team, some of whom are actually here tonight. And
so anyway,
it's a divine. You can find it and see what we're doing, just the craziness and the wonderfulness and the art and the moving image art on cosm.tv. It's a YouTube channel. And you can see all of our offerings. We have something under 100 offerings, but there's lots of interesting art and people and interviews.
There's an interview with Justin of Tool.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and there's an interview with Duncan Trussell and a bunch of people. We do that kind of thing as well. We try to cover some
artists.
Art and consciousness. Mm. Yeah, and so
I... Send me a question about art and life. Ask Allyson about art and life at my, you know, email address, allyson@cosm.org. Well, actually, Allyson Grey, allysongrey.com. You can find Ask Allyson about art and life and all some of the fun things that people ask me and we talk about. And you can ask me a question.